All right, everybody. Final session of the conference, and it's a good one. I know a lot of you were looking forward to hearing from Dr. Michael Clark, and you're about to. Dr. Michael Clark received his PhD in economics from George Mason University in 2011. He's currently an assistant professor at Hillsdale College, where his hard work and high teaching evaluations garnered him the chair in free market economics. Before Hillsdale, he taught as a visiting professor for the MBA program at the University of Baltimore. While his passion lies in the classroom, his research has also been fruitful. He has been published in academic journals such as the Adam Smith Review, Reason Papers, and the Independent Review. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Michael Clark.
All right, guys. Genuine question here. I don't have like a feel of the room. I don't know, like different groups will think different things about this. Why do you think in your head? Don't shout out a response or whatever. Just come up with what you think the answer to this question is. And my question is, how much wealthier is the average person in the United States compared to when I was born? Are we less wealthy? Are we more wealthy? Like, where are we at in this? And how much wealthier are we, or how much poorer are we? So the average person in the United States, since I was born, okay? And now I know what most of you guys are thinking is you're actually going through and not thinking about how wealthy the average person is. You're just sitting there and going, how old's this dude? Right? Like, I was born in 1982, okay? So, and a couple of high school kids are all like, oh no, right? So I was born in 1982. The average person in the United States, wealthier, poorer now? What do we think? Okay, so everybody kind of has in their head their own idea here. Out of curiosity, how many of you guys think wealthier? So show of hands, how many think wealthier? Out of show of hands, how many of you guys think poorer? Okay, so it's a pretty big majority poorer. Let me go to the wealthier then. Wealthier, how much wealthier do you think that we actually are? Like a little bit wealthier? Like, hey, if we made, you know, $100,000 a year in 1982, now we make $110,000 a year. Those would be big numbers, but like, what do you think? Are we twice as wealthy? Five times as wealthy? Eh, like a, you know, 5% increase. What do you think? So who's wealthier? What do we got? Anybody? What do you think? Just a little bit. Okay, that kind of goes with what I was thinking we might end up with in here. Since I've been a child, if I watch the news, or if you see headlines, things like that, the stories are all about like, man, the average American citizen, the middle class is deteriorating, we're falling apart, like America is crumbling, the foundations of capitalism are crushing. Right? Like, oh, they're just crushing us. People are getting poorer, all this kind of stuff. I have to tell you guys, my lived experience is different than those news stories, though. And you might say, oh, okay, well, like, spoiled kid, you know, or something like that. I didn't grow up really particularly spoiled or anything like that, but my lived experience, and just through observation as an economist, is a little bit different than that. In fact, one of the stories that I want to tell you guys about is really what happened to me about a month ago that inspired this talk. And so I was in a Walmart parking lot. This is a true story, okay? I'm just sitting in a Walmart parking lot, and my beautiful wife, who carries the load for our family, is in Walmart while I'm sitting in the car with our four kids in a van, okay? So I'm just sitting there, and I see this truck, and it has like this weird thing on the back of it, and it's got like this arm. I mean, it's just like a normal pickup truck or whatever, but it's got this weird thing in the back, and I'm like, hey kids, watch this. And so they do what all kids do when a parent says, hey kids, watch this, is they totally ignore me and roll their eyes, right? And I'm like, nah, not that worried about it or whatever, but then I start to see what's happening here. And this thing, like, it's in the back of the truck, and this, it's like moving out, and I'm like, what is this? This is neat. I'm like, kids, no, you are watching this. And what happened is I saw two teenagers, about your guys' age, got out of the truck and came around from like the passenger side, and they're right by the driver's side. And the driver's side door it opens up, and a guy, the chair kind of comes out. And there's a guy controlling the machine in the back of the truck, and there's somebody coming out of the driver's seat. Guys, it's the driver's seat is like coming out of the car. The individual in the driver's seat has no legs. I want you to think about that for a second. The individual in the driver's seat did not have legs. What was happening is he had a wheelchair lift, and his kids could have like gotten it for him, but he wanted to be able to live his life under his way and to be able to do things on his own. And so they sat there and they waited and watched while this thing came through and came over, and he did all the work and he got in the chair, and then the machine closed up and he was good to go, right? It was amazing to me. I had my children watch it. This is like a version. I looked at these online. The one I saw was actually way cooler than this, but this is like the best. This isn't like the actual scenario or whatever, right? This is the best picture representation I could get of it. Guys, I live in Hillsdale County, which is the poorest county in the state of Michigan. And I was in a Walmart parking lot. I wasn't at some tech expo or something like that. This happened a month ago, right? This happened to me a month ago. I think through these type of stories when I see economic claims thrown around and the average person thinking about the wealth in the world today versus my lived experience. And I think we forget, and especially a lot of you guys in here, because you haven't lived long enough. When I was your age, I hadn't lived long enough to actually be able to kind of look back and see the differences that have actually occurred. Wealth, to me, is vastly improved by my lived experiences, right? So if we think about the things that we had versus when I was born, and then we start to think about how ubiquitous a lot of these things are. So just think through, like, guys, in like 1990 versus today even. I was born in 82, we'll make it even smaller. 1990 versus today. Have you guys ever seen like a cell phone from like 1990? Those like big block things, and you'd carry, they're like bags. You had a bag phone. There's these huge things. And you could only get those if you were the richest of the rich. How many of you guys in here right now have a cell phone, your own? I mean, think about that for a second. That's not a weird thing in any old high school that every single person has a cell phone. Well, by 1990 standards, you were the richest of the rich. Do you guys want to compare the quality of yours versus theirs? Okay, like that is worth something. Those things are worth something. You go through tons of examples. I'm going to fly through some. But you think of like cameras. When I was growing up, early 1990s, we had disposable cameras were like the coolest thing. That was like the new technology. It was like you took pictures and then you like turned them in to get them developed and you just threw away the camera. Like that was really, really cool, right? Now you guys can just take thousands and thousands on that same device, the phone. Computers is obvious, but even more subtle than computers. You guys won't even probably know this, but maybe your parents will. You can ask them about this. But even like the quality of simple things on computers, like the mouse, has greatly increased. So for the longest time, when you had a computer and you had the mouse, what you had to do is you had to take off the little bottom thing and pull the ball out of it because it would get all gucked up with lint and dust and all this kind of stuff. So a mouse used to look like this thing over here. And now we have the little laser on the bottom. It's better. It's higher quality than it used to be, right? Noise-canceling headphones are so cool now. Hearing aids are so cool now, right? I was at a graduation ceremony this last May, and a professor had come back for the graduation ceremony, and he goes, I was like, you really want to come to these things? They're like 4 hours long. And he's like, yeah, because I got hearing aids now. And I was like, oh, so you used to not be able to hear it as well or something. You had hearing problems, but now you have a hearing aid so you can actually hear the ceremony and all that kind of stuff. Neat. And he goes, no. I hear, you know, I always had heard pretty well, but now I have hearing aids and you can get Bluetooth on these things. I'm listening to the game and tell the parts that I care about, right? Like the quality of that stuff didn't exist. None of that stuff is there, right? Fancy coffee is ubiquitous. In 1990, there was 84 Starbucks in the world. Now there's about 36,000, right? And that is not just, oh, a company. Fancy coffee like didn't really exist, let alone like the Keurigs that we have in our house versus like the just pots that you would make before, right? In the 1990s, this is what lawn chairs looked like. When I, again, in Hillsdale County, in Hillsdale, Michigan, which is one of the poorest counties in the state of Michigan, right? I go to a little soccer game or a little league game or something like that. Almost every single parent that I see on the sidelines has some like, you know, rocker thing. It's got, I don't know, who knows what's going on. There's all this technology to the simple, stupid little lawn chairs that we have, right? There's all kinds of stuff. When you go to a hotel now, you have free Wi-Fi. That didn't even exist in places before. I have access to so many different board games throughout the world because you can go on Amazon and buy stuff from Germany and Australia and all this other. One of my favorites is zero churn lawnmowers. Oh, once you get on one of those babies. Right? And once you start saying things like that, that's when you know you're old, right? That's when you know that you're old. It's like, oh, a zero churn lawnmower. Oh, like you can't go back. Delivery, like same day delivery and delivery groceries and things like that. That's relatively new that stuff's going on all over the place. We used to use these things that were called maps. They're these physical little like things that we had in our cars and we would like be like, I gotta get on Highway 12, right, to go somewhere. Now, what do your parents do? They plug in a little, you know, block and it jumps up and it says, turn left now to them everywhere that they go. It even tells them, hey, there's a traffic jam ahead. You might want to get off and go over here, or things like that, right? There's all these different kinds of things, dial-up to Wi-Fi even, video game systems. You guys ever played video game systems from like the early 1990s? Yeah, you do, because you have access to video games from the history of humanity in video games. Didn't have that when I was growing up. You get to play retro games, cool games, high graph. You can do it on your cell phone. You can do it wherever you want. LED bulbs, they're more efficient, brighter, cheaper, all this kind of stuff. FaceTime, Zoom chats, all of these things, right? When I was growing up, we had this movie. It was an animated movie called Beauty and the Beast. And in the movie Beauty and the Beast, Belle looks into the enchanted mirror and can see her father far off, struggling through the snow, right? And I was once told this story that a fellow professor of mine, his little daughter watched this movie, and his daughter said, why doesn't Belle just talk to her dad? I was like, well, because it's a magic mirror. Yeah, I have one of those things, and we talk to Graham and Gramps all the time, right? It's like, well, it doesn't work that way. Yeah, magic wasn't as good as what we have. Like, magic wasn't as good, right? We used to rent movies from a place called Blockbuster. This is like a 2000s Blockbuster, right? Please be kind, rewind. We had to like rewind these things. We had to go to the store. You guys just click a button and you have movies and TV shows and all different kind of niche things that you like. So one of the more recent things that came out was a documentary on Barry Sanders. I grew up a Detroit Lions fan. I can find that and love that. Like, you can find the specific things that you like. The number one thing that I watch on TV is the Disc Golf Network. Easily. Anybody in here like disc golf? Yes. Right? Paul Macbeth and Calvin Heinberg. Any of you guys in here have no idea what I'm talking about? Oh, how cool is that I can watch TV frequently about something that I love that most of you don't even have a clue about? When I was growing up in the 1990s, we got cartoons Saturday mornings, news, certain sets of TV shows, that was it. Right? That was it. Those are the trade-offs. Speaking again about the movies, one of my favorite things about renting movies, one of my favorite examples of this, and it's the season, guys. So I have to bring up this example. Yeah. Who doesn't like Home Alone, right? The wet bandits in Home Alone. Why did they break into the McAllister house? Why were they so fixated on the McAllister house? That little Kevin, like go somewhere else. Why did they want to go to the McAllister house? Watch the movie. What is the answer? Because they had a bunch of stuff like VCRs. Watch the movie. That's the reason. They say, oh, they got VCRs and stuff. Guys, think about that. That passed as wealthy in the 1990s. They had some VCRs. If I told you guys, if I came up here and I was like, hi, I'm Michael Clark from Hillsdale College. I just want you guys to know, I got 3 VCRs at home. Like as though I was something because of that, you would be like, who is this guy and what a joke, right? But the McAllisters, oh man, they had VCRs. And like we watched the movie and we didn't like sit there and go like, what? They're trying to break into this house because there's VCRs there? Movie theater seats. You guys, they didn't always used to look the way that they look now. If you've ever been to like an old movie theater that hasn't updated in a long time, that's what every movie theater looked like. Now you got recliners and all this other stuff and you can lift your feet up and you got actual space instead of being right on top of somebody that you don't know while they're like dropping popcorn all over you and this kind of stuff. Wheeled luggage was like a rare, expensive thing when I was growing up, right? Now you guys like do it with your backpacks, right? Like it's all over the place. And there's other things that we don't even think of, like seedless grapes and seedless watermelons weren't really common things back then. Like it was a very different thing. The Honeycrisp apple, any apple aficionados out there? Those are the best ones. Honeycrisp apples are the best ones. Amen. Yeah, they are. They just are. You couldn't purchase them in 1990. They weren't available for like wide-scale purchase even. Like our food has even changed. If you're thinking, hey, this guy is just talking about a lot of frivolous stuff, though, right? If you want to go to more serious stuff, science and medicine, the advances are too many to name, but a stark one that stuck out to the national eye is the handling of HIV, which has gone from a death sentence to a treatable disease. In 1990, other health issues that we could think about, there was about 50 Trader Joe's in the world, and now there's about 500. Whole Foods and other similar places have sprouted up all over the place during the last 15 years or so. The ability and the access to health food options at grocery stores has grown tremendously. The prevalence of things like LASIK eye surgery, that wasn't a thing when I grew up, and now it's very common. And to safety features and other health issues on things like cars. The fatalities per mile driven in a car has almost been cut in half since 1990. We're not even talking about since I was born in 1982. Guys, my lived experience tells me that we are much wealthier than when I was born, but what does the news tell you? What do the headlines say? What does the average person think? It's that we have gotten poorer and poorer and poorer. As an economist, I don't particularly like that. And if you think I'm just picking neat little funny examples or something like that, let me go to the data. And this is like the standard economic data. It's so standard, it's gonna have a boring slide. Because that's like what I'm doing. I'm pulling from the official Federal Reserve economic database. Look at that slide. Woo! Fred, man. Okay, so but if you look at that, 1982, we're around $33,000 per capita GDP, and now we're around 66. And I know because it's been in the news the last couple of years, a couple of you guys are smart and you're like, yeah, but inflation, right? Yeah, but this is adjusted for inflation. It's real per capita GDP. So this is with that already factored in. This is the average per capita GDP in the United States has doubled during my lifetime. And almost every single one of you in here said we've gotten poorer, or a couple of you said, yeah, we've gotten wealthy, but not much. That should make you pause a little bit. Like you don't really understand the economic situation that we're in. Everybody walks around with an intuitive economics, like just a basic understanding of what is happening in the economy, even if you're not like consciously thinking of it. But it's not really necessarily lining up with any kind of model, theory, or empirical data. right? We're telling ourselves some stories. There's some reasons why I think we do not appreciate the wealth in the world that we have. A lot of them are psychological. But I want to share one from the world of economics, teach you guys a little bit of economics, and try and help you understand. So when you see this argument, hopefully by having been to my talk, you guys will be prepared to kind of counter this argument. So the argument basically goes like this, is people say, no, we're way poorer than we used to be. And so I had this happen to me once. I was in Las Vegas and we had a waiter and he said, listen, my mom was a teacher and she could afford a house. And now I have a friend who's a teacher and they can't even afford a house. Like they have to like rent an apartment and all this kind of stuff. And it was kind of funny because my wife was with me and my wife was a teacher at the time. So like I knew, and I was in grad school at the time. I wasn't making any money, I was paying money, right? So I knew what it was like to live off of a teacher's salary at that time. And I'm not saying it's super easy or anything like that, but they were telling me, oh, like, you know, this is way worse and all that kind of stuff. Like, how do you counter that? If you're telling me we're twice as wealthy on average, like, how do you counter that, right? Like, how is there any logic to defeat that? And you see, I see videos on YouTube now, all this, oh, my mom was, you know, and they say, I had the same job as my mom, and my mom afforded this lake house. And now I have to live with my parents and things like that. Okay, here's a little game I want you to think about. Little thought. How many of you guys in here like Snickers bars? Okay, how many of you guys like Snickers bars now? Okay, I got a few more out of that. Right? Okay. Hands up again. Snickers bars. Who likes them? Yeah? All right, let's go right here. Still hand up. Right here. Snickers bar, do you want one?
Yes, please.
Okay, I got a deal for you though. What's your name?
Sophia.
Whoops. Snickers bar or Kit Kat and four Twixes?
Oh. I'll take the second option.
You're going to take the second option. That's kind of weird. All right, here you go. You get it? Yeah?
Yeah.
All right, do with it as you please. Give it up for Sophia. Did I just give out some candy and that's it?
Yeah. We're friendly.
I want you to think about this for a second, okay? Back in the day, a teacher could afford the house, right? And now they can't. But my argument thus far has been, but they got a lot of other things. A lot of other things that we don't account for. Like tons of other things that they're affording, like the Wi-Fi, the safer cars, the healthcare, all of health food, Starbucks every day, right? The stuff on their phone, all that kind of stuff. Well, this is how we go through and we think about this. When we think we get more wealth, we think we should get everything we currently have and more. We feel entitled to absolutely everything that the world could have, but the reality of what economics teaches us is that the world is made of trade-offs. There are trade-offs everywhere. So when we think through this, drop here, right, we go, oh, Snickers, or we could have this, right? What did Sophia say was better? She said that the second option was better, but guys, she doesn't have any Snickers. So isn't she worse off? No, right? Like, hey, it would be like saying, I have to rent a house now, but I also get 9,000 other awesome things, and then pointing to the fact that you can't afford to buy your own house and saying, well, I must be worse off then. It's like the Snickers saying, well, I don't have a Snickers, so I must be worse off then. No, that's not the way that it is. We have so much other wealth around us, right? So when you see those examples, they can be true. That's great. The world is not meant to be perfect, and we're not ever going to have everything we want. You guys, once you have everything you want, you know what happens to us? Is we adjust to what we have, and we want more. I'm not saying that's a great thing. I'm not applauding that as like this wondrous element. But there's this true nature to us that pushes us forward. And we have to learn throughout our life to balance that, to avoid greed and becoming consumed with me, 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 and wanting more, but also to want some of that to push us forward. It's a balance. We adjust very, very quickly to the settings that we're in. So we think, oh, we'll be just fine. Once we get there, we'll be good. And like we think that we'll make it somewhere and like the world will change for us, right? The reality is it's almost like a treadmill. Once we take a step, it kind of just comes back to where we were. And we want to keep taking that step forward and that step forward when it comes to these other elements in wealth. So we have to learn to control that, to not succumb to that greed, but also to acknowledge the fact that that exists, right? So my point so far has just basically been that we tend to overlook and underappreciate the wealth that we have. I think the average person doesn't really appreciate how miraculous our wealth is either. They don't see how tough it is to achieve the levels of wealth that we have achieved. They don't appreciate how much of a challenge it is. One of my favorite ways to explain this is a classic example in a short essay that I encourage all of you guys to read. And it's the essay by Leonard Reed called I, Pencil. Right? Near the start of I, Pencil, I'm going to read just a little snippet of this to you guys. I, Pencil is an autobiography of a pencil. It's like the classic read in all of economics, and it's an autobiography of a pencil. Right? Here's a little snippet from it. It says, "But sadly, I am taken for granted by those who use me, as if I were a mere incident and without background. This attitude, this taking for granted, this entitlement that you should have these things, this attitude relegates me to the level of commonplace. This is a species of grievous error in which mankind cannot too long persist without peril. For the wise G.K. Chesterton observed, we are perishing for want of wonder, not for want of wonders. I, Pencil, simple though I appear to be, merit your wonder and awe, a claim I shall attempt to prove. In fact, if you can understand me, no, that is too much to ask anyone. If you can become aware of the miraculousness which I symbolize, you can help save the freedom mankind is so unhappily losing. It is a simple pencil, you guys. And the claim in the essay that this right here, that no one person on the face of this earth can make a pencil. That seems silly. That seems like a very bold claim. I argue easily that this is true. No one person on the face of this earth can make a pencil by themselves. There are not very many pieces to a pencil, right? You have the wood in the middle. We could even say without the paint, right? You got the paint on the outside, the wood in the middle. You got the little, you know, the black stuff in the middle that we call lead. You got the eraser. Does anybody know what the metal part is called? Okay, so we just figured out that no one in this room even knows the name of things on pencils, let alone how to make one. It's the ferrule, right, that you go through. Okay, let's think of this. What's the easiest place to start with making a pencil? I would say it would be like to get the wood, like that's the big chunk of that. Let's think about somebody on the face of this earth trying to get the wood to make their own pencil, right? So first off, generally the best wood for pencils turns out comes from the Pacific Northwest. We're not that far away. But if you use other types of wood, a lot of times it becomes too brittle or it doesn't really work with holding things or whatever. You gotta go get like cedar's the best or whatever it is, right? So you gotta go to the Pacific Northwest. Okay, we're not that far away. How are you gonna get there? Anybody wanna walk to Washington? Okay, but let's say somehow we were there already. We're in the state of Washington, right? And now, what does anybody know what substance this wood thing is made out of? Like, where could you go find wood in nature? It's a tree, right? The educational system is working. It's a tree, right? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go chop down a tree. And so we need an axe, right, to chop down this tree. So we're gonna take our axe. Well, wait, if we're doing this by ourselves, we don't have an axe yet, so let's make an axe, and we'll take the handle of the axe, and it'll be made out of, like wood. Oh, so wait, so now I need a tree. How am I gonna chop down a tree to give me an axe so I can chop down a tree? I'm a little bit of problems. Yeah, we can solve it with Minecraft, right? Like that's gonna work. There we go. You got it. Yeah, what do you got for me? Okay, let's say a stick's not gonna work, or a branch. We need something pretty serious here. Okay, it's on the ground. Now what are you gonna do with that branch on the ground? Peel the bark off, and you're gonna get it to look like this guy right here. Whittle it away or something like that, right? Okay, well, cool. Now all you gotta do is somehow figure out a way to get a nice little hole in that thing. Perfect size for this. What's in the middle of this? It's kind of like a mix of graphite. So we need actually some mud from like the Mississippi River. You have to also go overseas to the, like what was formerly, I think, Sri Lanka or somewhere way, way far away to actually get some of the graphite that's mined from this, right? How are you going to do all of these things, right? Even the fact of like the rest of the, you know, hatchet or axe that we need to grind away on stuff, that's steel. How are you gonna get steel? How are you gonna go through all these things? No one on the face of this earth can do this. It takes millions of people to cooperate. Just the loggers alone that get the wood from the Pacific Northwest, they need the help of all of those tools. And then how do those tools ever get there? We need people to ship those tools. We need people to feed the people that ship those tools. A simple little pencil like this involves millions and millions of people to make this. Leonard Reed chose this on purpose because it's the simplest thing that you can come up with. He was copying a little essay from Adam Smith, where Adam Smith talks about, you know, in The Wealth of Nations, he talks about a woolen coat, a simple, simple object. Right? Millions are involved in figuring out a way to bring it to the market. They find different ways to make this little part cheaper, that little part cheaper, and they pitch in and they do their part. A lot of them don't know they're a part of the family tree of the pencil. Does the truck driver who is shipping some graphite over, you know, to where they're putting it together, does he know? Probably not. Does the person who's pouring the cup of coffee for the truck driver? Probably not. Millions of people are involved in the simplest little objects. You guys grew up and you experienced a little bit of this during COVID, because the supply chains all of a sudden shut down and we realized how interconnected our world was, because the simplest of items couldn't get somewhere. The supply chains are from thousands and thousands of different things can be shut down by just small little sectors. So then how in the world is it that we ever get a pencil? How do we get that cooperation from millions of people to make something so simple, let alone the complex items that you carry around in your pocket, or the clothes that you're wearing, or the chairs in this room, to the microphone in here, versus all the complex stuff that we have? How do we get all of this stuff then? It requires a price system. It requires the ideas of profit and loss in economies that are based on freedom and property rights. It hasn't happened in the world where we get this level of wealth and this level of cooperation unless we have those things. The price system sends a clear message that if I am going to provide a whole bunch of equipment that helps cut down trees and no one needs to cut down a tree, what is going to happen to my business? Is it going to be doing swell? Is everything going to be going swimmingly? I don't think so. I'm going to be losing all kinds of money. So I get out of that market. But then there's gonna be other markets where things are going awesome and they're making all kinds of money. So would you like to open up a business in that industry and you know, also do those kind of things? Yeah, you would. The price system is a signal wrapped in an incentive. It's a signal, where do we need things? And it also incentivizes you to do those particular things. That free enterprise system relies on the price system. It relies on property rights. It relies on economic freedom, and it has made us vastly wealthier in places where we have been able to actually adopt those institutions. It's not easy to adopt those institutions, but you should be aware that you are living in a country that at its foundation has those institutions. You are incredibly lucky to live in the world that you live in. We are coming off of a Thanksgiving weekend and everybody is in such a rush to get to Christmas. But I want you to think about Thanksgiving for real. Think about how thankful you should be to live in the world that you actually live in. This is a little graph that we call the hockey stick of human history and economics. Throughout all of human history, wealth has been basically flatline. A few rich elites, hey, have done kind of well, and they've had incredible things. We live now greater than the kings of past. All of human history, flatline, flatline, flatline. And then we get this big spike in certain areas, like England and the United States in the mid-18th century. It starts to spike up. Adam Smith writes an inquiry into the nature and causes of the wealth of nations in 1776 and says, "My goodness, how wealthy we are." And we are so much wealthier than we were then. Cornelius Vanderbilt is widely considered to be the wealthiest man to ever live. That's a joke. He didn't have clean drinking water. He didn't have access to air conditioning. Like, these are things you guys just like couldn't live without, right? Didn't have cars, didn't have cell phones, didn't have all this kind of stuff. The countries that have hopped on the hockey stick of human history are countries that have adopted things like the rule of law, property rights, and free markets. Freedom creates wealth, and it's empirically a reality. It's empirically a reality. So let's think about what I've said so far. We don't appreciate how much wealth we have. We don't even recognize that we have wealth. And then we don't appreciate how tough it is to get wealth. The iPencil story, we like don't even realize like a pencil is a miracle. Like you guys don't walk into Walmart in, you know, the fall getting your school supplies and go, "Wow, they have a pencil for me." You should. It's amazing that somebody has a pencil for you. Right? My homework assignment for you is to walk into Walmart's pencil aisle and just stand there and go, "Whoa." And think about how amazing it is. Because they don't just have a pencil for you. They got all kinds of color options and lead types and, "Oh, this one, I don't like the way this one fits my hand." Right? Like, come on. You are so wealthy. Be grateful for what we actually have. We don't understand that we actually are wealthier, and we don't understand how tough it is to get the wealth that we actually have. This is a recipe to me for disaster. The iPencil essay said, "If I could just make you aware of my miracle, I think that could save the freedom that we are losing." To close, I want you to think back to my opening example, the Walmart parking lot, with the man in the truck. Because most of my examples so far have been about the cool things that you and I get to have. And if you're in this room, you're probably pretty lucky. You're probably pretty fortunate. But what correlates really, really well with helping those who aren't as fortunate are the things that I have been listing in here. The most free countries in the world, the countries that increase per capita GDP are the countries that have the wealthiest poor people in the world. The least among us, if you want to help them, if you want to care about them, and not just be concerned with the stories that I tell of getting to have a downloadable movie versus a VCR and a VHS and all these kind of things, right? If you care about the least among us, then you need to better understand where wealth is coming from. Like, how do we help others get wealth if we don't think about where the wealth has come from? So I challenge you guys to think about that guy in the truck that I saw in the Walmart parking lot that was in the poorest county in the state of Michigan, and somebody got to live their life who was not the most fortunate because we have the institutions that we have. That didn't happen in the 1990s, didn't happen in the 1980s, and it doesn't happen in most places throughout the world. You need to be a better citizen and become more informed. You guys are at the point in time in your life where you are coming into becoming your own individual. And you have to understand, what do you stand for? What do you believe? And understand the world around you. And part of that understanding should be a little bit of economics to understand how the free enterprise system works, how you are as blessed as you actually are. I have 4 recommendations of readings for you guys. I'm gonna put them up here for you guys to kind of get you started. I really encourage you guys to read Russ Roberts' short essay. Just give me 2 pages, guys. 2 pages, Russ Roberts' Profit Versus Love. And after you read that, read Leonard Reed's I, Pencil. Okay, so I told you the story, but it's way better. The essay is way better than what I told you. Mine was just a little teaser trailer. After you do that, we got to step to the book level and you read Thomas Sowell's Basic Economics. It's a bigger book, but it's easy to read, and he's one of the best economic communicators of our generation, if not the best economic communicator of our generation. And then finally, I encourage you to kind of integrate this to your other studies that you've done throughout middle school and high school and things like that by reading Bert Folsom's Myth of the Robber Barons. Bert comes here frequently and speaks for YAF, but it'll tie in your history lessons to the economics that you're reading, and you'll better be able to interpret some of the things that you already know and understand, and you'll understand them in a deeper way. And if you get past all of this, then you can come study with me at Hillsdale College. Deal? All right, guys, keep coming to YAF events. Expose yourself to these kind of ideas. Challenge these ideas. Test them. Try and think about them critically. See if it holds up. I think truth will out, and I am putting these ideas in front of you guys. You will be a better steward of the institutions and the ideas that you have been so blessed, and that you will actually be able to be a better steward of those ideas. To me, that's almost a responsibility that you have by having these blessings. Keep them alive for future generations. That's my time. Thank you guys very much for your attention. I really appreciate it. Q&A or no?
Yeah.
If you guys have a couple of questions, that's great. Otherwise, I can speak to you guys afterwards. But a couple of questions from you guys, if anybody has anything.
Yes, if you have a couple, we want to line up over here for Q&A. Remember to state your name, school, and a brief
All
question.
Right. We got some.
Name, school, age.
Okay. Hey, my name is Santiago Tarango. I go to Heritage Christian Academy. So you're an economist, right?
Yep.
So what exactly do you do like as a day-to-day job?
What does an economist do? We are known as like the imperial field. We invade everything. So what doesn't an economist do? Economists can do all different kinds of things. That's kind of the benefit of the degree. Even at the undergraduate level, if you study economics, you can go into lots of different things. You can go to law school, you can go to econ grad school stuff, you can go into politics, you can go work into like the world of finance or the business sector. It's like anything. Economists are everywhere. So it depends on what type of economist you actually are. So some people deal in the financial sector, whatever, things like that. That's kind of the stereotype. Other people are like looking at or work at government institutions like the World Bank or the Federal Reserve, and they do kind of studies and academic work and papers and analysis of what's happening in the economy, try and report on that. You see people on the news, you have podcasters, you have people all over the place. Me, what do? I communicate economic ideas, basic economic ideas. So I teach at Hillsdale College, which is a small liberal arts institution that has a huge reach. And so all of you guys here should at least look into it. It's a tough school to get into. But if you can get into it, it provides a wonderful education. I am there. I teach econ to other students, and I try and go to events like this. That's kind of my role, is sharing the ideas. But economists look at economic data. Sometimes firms care about that stuff. Sometimes government agencies, all over the place. Everything. It's not a good answer because it's everything.
We have time for one last question.
Hi, my name is Noelle Mazur. I go to Cameron High School, and I was wondering if I could have the Snickers bar.
I will give you the Snickers bar.
Because you're kind and don't want to make me.
If you can tell me, if you can tell me the name of this graph right here. Don't say it. Nobody else say it.
Yeah, I don't know.
Hands, let me see, somebody else. All right, I got you in the middle in the back. We're the first one up, yep. Nope, somebody else. You, right here. It's not exactly what I called it. In the back. Nope, right here. GDP, no. You, in the green, in the green. Nope. Nope. You. Nope. You, go, oh, no, yes. What did I call it?
Think of complicated things.
No.
I think I get the Snickers bar.
I think that's a good argument. There you go.
What was it called?
The hockey stick of human history. The hockey stick of human history. All right, guys, thank you guys so much. This is a true joy for me to get to come out here. I really appreciate it. I hope you guys had a wonderful event. You guys also, since we're at the end here, I want you guys to give it up for the YAF staff. They do an incredible job for you guys. Thank you guys. All right, we'll get you guys on out of here. All right, listen to Madison. Oh, I have it.